Even before I start my talk, let me first deal with one thought process that I have to encounter in every program of mine. Impracticality is the vocabulary of a mediocre who does not want to take the responsibility of implementation. I repeat, impracticality is the vocabulary of a mediocre who does not want to take the responsibility of implementation. For example, all of us sitting here, do we understand our health is important? Yes. At least from January 1st to January 10th, we always understand our health is important. January 1st, you can't park at Marina Beach. Every fellow in town has made a New Year resolution. From today, he's going to exercise. Till January 10th, you won't get parking space in Marina Beach. From January 10th, you can park near the lighthouse. By January 25th, only you and Gandhi will be standing there in the beach. There's a beautiful Italian saying. It says, let all your miseries in life be as short-lived as your New Year resolutions. That is the lifespan. And that's the purpose of this talk. That let's not cheat ourselves one more time as we move into January 1st, 2008. By making a few new resolutions, put ourselves down. Because if you cannot live by your own promises, forget it. You will never be able to look up to yourself. You'll never be able to look up to yourself. The greatest tragedy in life is to fall in your own eyes. And every time you make a promise saying that from now onwards I'm going to do it and don't end up doing it, you keep falling in your own eyes. With every promise you give to the world outside you don't live by, you fall in the eyes of the world. With every promise you give to yourself and you don't live by, you fall in your own eyes. You think it's a very small event the previous night to set the wake-up call next morning for 6 o'clock, and when it rings, you put it off and go to sleep. You think it's a very small incident, but you don't know the sort of psychological blow it has on you. The psychological blow it has on you is deep inside your own system is asking you, you can't even get up at the time at which you want to get up. Where are you going to accomplish great things in life? Nobody in the outside is doubting your abilities. Something inside you is doubting your abilities because it is saying, you only promised that next 1 year I am going to exercise on a regular basis. And in the entire year, you could not even exercise for more than 55 days or 65 days or 4 months. So your own system is asking you, if for 365 days you can't live up to a commitment you gave yourself, what makes you think you can live a life of lifetime of greatness? The one who is doubting your abilities is not outside, it's inside. The enemy that we must win is the enemy within, not outside. With every commitment you give yourself, with every promise you make yourself that you are not able to live by, you fall in your own eyes. The greatest tragedy of life is to fall in your own eyes. Of course, the greatest pride is to grow in your own eyes. You think when you set the wake-up call at 6 o'clock and you wake up at 6 o'clock, it's a very simple incident. It's not a simple incident. Something within you is beginning to believe in yourself. Something within you, with every small promise made and lived by, is beginning to believe in yourself. Anybody who knows me personally knows there's nothing extraordinary about the person who is speaking to you. I'm a very simple, ordinary, mamul, day-to-day neighborhood human being. There's nothing special about it. Some of my teachers are sitting here and they know that. They'll vouch for it. They think I'm a spiritual accident. Then how come we have produced the results we have produced? How come we are awakening a new humanity? How come Alma Mater has grown into such a force? What in our abilities is making Frozen Thoughts grow into a magazine that goes to 54 countries in the world? What is there? I know there is nothing extraordinary. Yet something has been happening now for 13 years. For 13 years, I have been on time for all the appointments. 13 years. 13 years, not a single program of Alma Mater has started late. For 13 years, we have not allowed anybody who is late inside our program. For 13 years, hundreds of public programs, hundreds of satsangs, thousands of one-to-one meetings, thousands of classes, and everything has started on time. 13 years ago, I told the world, if I tell you, I'll see you at 3 o'clock, and at 3 o'clock, if I am not there, tell the whole world I'm dead. The only reason I could have given you an appointment and not be there on time is I should have already died, otherwise I'll be there. And for 13 years, we have lived up to it. You speak about practicality, Rajan. Practically speaking, I also live in the same world you live. I also have traffic jams. For me also, chief minister's vehicle go. For me also, presidents come. For me also, flights get delayed. For me also, I can be sick. For me also, my near and dear man might have certain necessities. For me also, the vehicle can have a breakdown. Everything can happen. But somehow the premium that has been put on commitment. If you're given a time, you live by that time. The difference between 5 and 5-1 to you is 1 minute. To me, it's 3,200 minutes. 1 minute of 3,200 people. There's an accountability to 3,200 minutes of human time. A very simple resolve. But unconsciously what has happened is, because of these small promises that you have lived by, small promises that you have lived by, small promises you have lived by, small promises you have lived by, 4 o'clock my wake up call, 4 o'clock is 4 o'clock. There has never been 4-5. 4 o'clock is my wake up time. I'll beat the clock, but the clock will not beat me a single day. Nothing great about it. A simple resolution to live up to the promises you give to yourself. That's it. But what had happened when you have done that for 13 years? Something within you has started believing in you. It says, for you, 3 o'clock is 3 o'clock. Sunday is Sunday. 5 o'clock is 5 o'clock. 7 o'clock will be 7 o'clock. There's no question of it starting at 5 and ending at 7:15. 7 o'clock will be 7 o'clock. And hence, when you say you will be able to exercise for next 365 days, I know you will, because when you say it, you do it. There is a tremendous sense of self-belief that has developed. In fact, there is no other way, not your MBA, not your PhD, not your MCA, not your MBBS, MD, FRs, nothing is going to give you the amount of self-belief as you're making those small promises to yourself and living by those promises. Every promise you uphold is another stroke in the painting called self-belief. Every promise you falter is another scratch on the painting of self-belief. Experience by experience, promise by promise, commitment by commitment, you're either painting another stroke on the painting of self-belief or you're scratching it. And if I live a lifetime of scratching it and then wonder why the painting has not emerged, it can't. And it is no surprise that a very ordinary person on whom nobody bet on, saying that he is going to make it in life, develops a painting because he keeps painting one stroke at a time, one stroke at a time, and anybody who strokes long enough will eventually have a painting. The greatest tragedy in life is to fall in your own eyes. With every promise made that you have not lived up to, something within you gets shaken up in self-belief. Something within you is perpetually, we read inspirational biographies, we read inspirational autobiographies, we read inspirational books, we listen to discourses, we get motivated by programs like this, and somehow we leave the program believing, I'm going to commit myself to a life of greatness. And yet when you sleep, something within you says, all this motivational stuff is okay, but do you think you can do it? Because you can't even wake up at the time you want to wake up. You can't even go. Last time you ran in the last minute to catch the flight, And you got stressed up, you begged every counter to let you in, and finally you made it to the flight, and you felt embarrassed when you were the last one to walk in and all the passengers were staring at you, and you resolved, from now onwards I'm going to plan a little early and I'm not going to go through the stress of running in the last minute. And yet next time you find yourself running around one more time. You said you will come by 7 o'clock and we'll go for the wedding. You ended up only at 8 o'clock. She was emotionally reckless and the peace of the house was spoiled, and you said you're never going to go through this anymore. From next time onwards, you're going to say 7 o'clock, you're going to be there at 7 o'clock, and next time also you're not there at 7. So something within you keeps asking, even in momentary experiences, if you cannot display greatness, how come you're going to live a lifetime of greatness? And when the one within you does not believe in you, doesn't matter how many other people believe in you, you're not going to make it in life. When the one within you believes you, even if nobody believes you, there's no force that can stop you from still crossing the finishing line. The greatest pride is to grow in your own eyes, and with every small promise made, you keep growing in life. So whenever we sit through a program, there's always this one conclusion with which people leave. Predominantly, whatever I heard is nice to listen to, but I don't think it's practical in life. We're not speaking rocket science here. We are saying, from tomorrow, decide what time you want to wake up and ensure that there is nothing on earth that can stop you from waking up at that time. I'm not even telling you what time to wake up. You decide. You want it to be early afternoon, 8 o'clock, it's okay with me. You make the decision what time. But if it's 8 o'clock, it's 8 o'clock. It's not 8:05. Not asking you to come and see at 3. You say only 3:30 is comfortable. Okay, we'll meet at 3:30. But 3:30 is 3:30. Not telling you from tomorrow, 1.5 hours exercise. 10 minutes you can exercise. And you make a decision, next 365 days, I'm going to exercise for 10 minutes. Make it 365 days for 10 minutes. 5 minutes, 3 minutes, 1 minute, I'll negotiate with you. What is not negotiable is 365 days. There's no negotiation on that. I will take up something and show myself I can also do it for 365 days without being absent. It's not to anybody else. It is to yourself that you have to show, even I can take up something in life and practice it for 365 days without being absent. One thing, not necessarily 10 things. Forget about the results you will get out of the exercise you do, or sitting in the seat of meditation, or being punctual, or being honest, or staying away from a habit. I don't know what it is. Forget about the other impact. The psychological growth that you're going to have by showing yourself, I could also take up something and practice it for 365 days without being absent. The sort of self-belief it will develop in you. Instead, what we do is we sit through a whole thing and we don't want to take the responsibility of implementation. So we leave by saying, it's nice to listen to, but it's not practical. What is impractical about waking up at a particular time? What is impractical about saying 10 minutes a day, I will do this on a daily basis, and to do it for the next 365 days? Rajan, I keep traveling. Of course. Wherever you travel, you brush your teeth. You don't say, because I'm traveling only in Chennai, when I'm there, I'll brush my teeth. Otherwise, I won't. Wherever you go, you have a bath, I assume. Wherever you go, you eat. So why, when it comes to certain new things, new commitments that you have to add to your life alone, traveling has to be a bottleneck? It need not be. Who gave you this feeling you can't do yoga when you travel? I don't think it's banned in Switzerland. Who gave you this feeling in Singapore you can't sit in the seat of meditation? Who gave us this feeling you can't be honest in Bangkok? Anything that we can take up, and it's a very simple thing, just to show yourself, I can also take up something and practice it for 365 days without being absent. Nothing impractical about it. Impracticality is the vocabulary of a mediocre who does not want to take the responsibility of implementation. the man that was created by the wisdom is no less. There's nobody who is less. The wisdom that created all of us the same. But in the life that we have lived, because we have let our own self-belief down by very low commitment levels, because we have continuously kept shaking ourselves up, and that is why sometimes when you observe from outside, you always look at somebody who is making it life and wonder how he made it in life. Intellectually, you score over him. Education-wise, you score over him. In terms of personality, you score over him. As a communicator, as a leader, you score over him. But in self-belief, he scores over you, and that is above everything else. The final qualification is self-belief. Get 100 out of 100 on knowledge, get 95 out of 100 on personality, get 90 out of 100 on communication, and get 45 out of 100 in self-belief, and you get 0, 0, 0 everywhere, 100 out of 100 on self-belief, you will find yourself led by him, and it's not the other way around. Impracticality is the vocabulary of a mediocre who does not want to take the responsibility. Because in 10 minutes time at 7:10, by concluding this is not practical, you're free for 1 year. By agreeing it's practical, now you have a responsibility for 1 year, and nobody wants to take that responsibility. And hence you think this is all fate, yesab takdeer hai, vidhi. But man is the co-author of his destiny. He is not the only author of your destiny. Man is the co-author of your destiny. God completes the sentences which you start. How you start the sentence is very crucial. And when those sentences are one of self-belief, when one of continuity, you live a different life. So let's shun the company of people who want to hide their mediocrity under the banner called impractically. And my speech is only for the rest of them who are willing to take the responsibility of implementation. The rest for me are donors. And to those few of you who want to implement and move forward in life, let's begin. Dinacharya is a very simple concept gifted to mankind by Ayurveda. There are many understandings, very deep understandings to it. Let's take a very simple understanding. It says, what you do on a daily basis, even imperfectly done, will give you far greater results than what you can do perfectly but do on an irregular basis. It says, if you want to develop yourself, let us say in vocal, you want to be a Carnatic musician, you want to be a Hindustani singer. Dinacharya says, 10 minutes a day, if you can practice your singing, even imperfectly, is going to give you far greater results in life than when you sing, neighborhood comes to a halt because they are stunned by the way you sing, in the right reasons. Maybe even when he sings, neighborhood comes to a halt. And 2 hours a day you are able to sing and stun yourself, but you do it only twice a week, it's not going to take you anywhere in life. 2.5 hours a day, twice a week, you practice yoga, and you find that the yoga is giving you tremendous feel. Those 2 days you feel great about yourself, is still going to give you far lesser results than a yoga you practice on a daily basis, say for 1/2 hour a day, but on a daily basis, is going to give you far greater results. On anything that you want to grow, on anything that you want to develop, on anything that you want to experience progress, the law of life being that on which I invest time grows. The law of life being that on which I invest time grows. If you feel that this relationship in my life has been phenomenally improving, that relationship in your life is improving because right now you are investing a lot of time in that relationship. If you feel this relationship in life is no more what it used to be, that is because that relationship is no more getting the time it used to get. 2007 was a brilliant experience as far as sales is concerned. The reason is the head of the organization has invested a lot of time in improving the sales strategies, motivating the sales team. But it so happened the number of customer complaints have dramatically increased. I've encountered more customer complaints this time than ever before because your customer service has suffered the investment of time. If right now you feel, last year physically you have become very fit, but intellectually there is a sense of lethargy that has come. The reason is last year there has been tremendous amount of investment of time on your physical health and you have not fed your intellectual growth enough. If last year was a year of tremendous spiritual growth, but at the same time that you find the business has been a little sluggish, if last year has been a tremendous excellence in your involvement with Rotary and you were awarded the outstanding president in the zone, but in the same period, your marriage has gone for a toss, it's not what it used to be, you don't have to think too far. That on which you invest time grows, that which you starve of your time shrinks. Dinacharya says, that on which you invest time on a daily basis grows towards perfection. That on which you invest time on a daily basis grows towards perfection. Anything that's done on a daily basis, even imperfectly, gives you far greater results than what you can do perfectly well but done inconsistently. And that is the premises of Dinacharya. The reason this talk is on December 30th is to appeal to all of you, rather than deciding that you're going to do 10 things in the year ahead, take one, take two, take three, take something within you, but take something that you're able to pledge you'll be able to practice for 365 days. Think. You have the rest of the evening and the rest of your tomorrow till you get liquid spiritual. Invest some time on solid spirituality and think. Step forward only in directions, whether it's professional, it's personal, it's spiritual, it's social. Only step forward in those directions. Then this year I really want to make major strides with my mridangam. Will you touch it all the 365 days? Will you touch it all the... Now, I want to excel in French. Will you read or write all the 365 days? I'm going to redefine the bar of health for me. Next year when I am standing there, I should be a much healthier person than what I am right now. Will you be able to do something with your body the remaining 365 days? No absenteeism allowed. I'm going to practice pranayama. Will you be able to do it on a daily basis for 365 days? Take three things. Take two. Take five. Now I'm going to quit smoking. Will you be able to do it for 365 days? Nothing is going to shake you more than giving up smoking on January 1st and picking it up again on January 12th. That means you have not dropped smoking. You dropped a cigarette and picked it up again. And why not? Why not live socially, morally responsible for 1 year? I know you won't like me for this talk. I'm not giving this speech to be liked. I'm giving this speech to make a difference. In fact, every person who argues against his habits, I ask all of them only one question. Yesterday I asked an auto rickshaw driver this question. Tomorrow when your children pick up these habits, will you be proud of them? Don't argue with me what is right and what is wrong. Tomorrow when your children pick up the habits for which you argue, will you feel proud of? The day you see your son with a cigarette, your daughter with a beer, will you go and say, I'm proud of you, my child, like father, like daughter? Will you? Will you go and tell your son, so many years I've been drinking alone. I'm so glad now I have a light company. Thank you, beta. I will no more feel alone. Your daddu was useless. Your mummy was useless. Nobody was giving me company, beta. Finally, I found in you. That is why I have told everybody also. Satsang means like-minded people. I've told them, heaven's sake, change that now. No more say satsang is like-minded people, because a set of bevdas are also like-minded people only. People coming together to drink is like-minded. Let's change satsang to right-minded people, not like-minded people. Will you feel proud tomorrow when your children pick up the habits that you are practicing? In fact, will you be able to look into the eyes of your children and say, beta, what you're doing is wrong? Unless I live morally a correct life, I don't have the moral right to tell anybody else what is morality. Unless I live morally a right life, I will not have the strength with which I can empower anybody. Will your daughter be safe tomorrow night? Can she go out at 11:30? Will your daughter be safe? Will she be able to come back exactly the way you sent? What society have you built? Will you be able to, the habits that you argue for, will you be able to practice and still look straight into the eyes of your parents? Will you be able to practice the habits that you argue for and enter a place of worship? Go till 12 o'clock, drink tomorrow, and straight go to temple. Both will happen, liquid spirituality, solid spirituality, both will happen. Go straight. After all, there's no board there that says, don't get drunk and come. Go. Will you be able to enter? So something within you knows it is wrong. Something within you knows it's wrong. Why all this? Your relationship with me, with many of you, is a few minutes old.